Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Healing Connections podcast. I'm your host, Emmy Vadnais, and today we have the great pleasure to talk about spirituality and psychology with Dave Roberts, who is a licensed master social worker and became a parent who experienced the death of a child when his daughter Janine died of cancer at the age of 18. He is a retired addiction professional and an adjunct professor in the psychology and psychology child life departments at Utica College. Dave has contributed to numerous articles on transformation of grief and addiction to several online sites and publications. His first book, which just was published, is co-authored with Reverend Patty Farino, When the Psychology Professor Met the Minister. Welcome, Dave.
Thank you, Emmy. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm excited to be a part of your podcast today.
Well, I feel very honored to speak with you. You have such a rich background. You've been an addiction counselor for 25 years. You're now a psychology professor, and you had a unique experience that you have put in your book with Patty Farino. And I was wondering if you could just share a little bit about your journey that led you to marry spirituality and psychology together.
Well, I think the journey probably started a day after my daughter's death, although I didn't know that. But my daughter Janine died on March 1st, 2003 of a very rare form of cancer. It was a alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma, which is a connective muscle tissue cancer. And it was the most aggressive type of sarcoma that she could have had. And from diagnosis to her transition, it was 10 months. And she died at home with hospice services. And that's, I mean, the abbreviated version of the story. But I can tell you that all of my training as a therapist, all of my education, didn't even begin to prepare me for the path I was about to embark on. Nothing, no book, no manual, no conference, no training prepares you to wrap your head around burying your child. It's an unnatural event. We are supposed to care. Our children are supposed to carry our legacies. It's not supposed to be the other way around. So I found myself at the age of 47 trying to determine, and I am going to paraphrase a quote from one of my favorite authors and musicians, the late Neil Peart, who in his book Ghostwriter Travels on the Healing Road said he traveled. He went on the road to try to determine the type of world he wanted to live in and the type of person he wanted to be. And I think that is the challenge for not only a parent who's lost a child, but anybody who has faced life-altering challenge. So I think it started that particular day. For 7 years, I thought I was handling the walk of a bereaved parent very well. I was teaching. I was beginning to embark on a writing career. Sharing bits and pieces of my journey, all in honor of and with my daughter. And I thought I was, I became a conference organizer in 2010 when we held a Beyond Words conference, Creative Approaches to Grief. And I was one of the conference organizers. And that's how Patty Farino and I met. And we detailed this in our book. She had attempted to register for the conference. She wanted to make sure she had all her workshops. She had everything in place. She was double checking everything before she tried to hit send, and then the screen went blank. So she saw the number. She got back on. She saw the number. She called me because she wanted to make sure that the registration came through. We all look at this now as kind of spirit's intervention. Because spirit, as you know, likes to kind of mess around with electronics a little bit in order to make a point. And so we looked at that as kind of that first serendipitous moment where we were meant to get together. So we talked for about 45 minutes. I got her registered. I asked her with very gentle care if she had lost a child, but she didn't. She told me about her work as the minister and coordinator for the Angel of Hope statue, and it was in Eisenhower Park in Long Island. And the Angel of Hope statue is erected specifically to honor parents, to honor children who have died. And so she ministered to a lot of parents who had lost a child. So we shared a lot of tears. We shared tears over Janine. We shared tears over two significant young men in her life at that time that had passed, that she had drawn close to. And then we vowed to give each other a big bear hug when we saw each other at the conference. So to make a long story short, I saw her at the last workshop of the day. She hugs me and she whispers in my ear, she goes, I think your daughter sent me a rainbow. And so I'm at the point of the conference where I'm tired. I'm saying, yeah, great. You know, that's great. I'm great, but I'm tired. I just want to go and I want to decompress. What happened is she told me in September about, before she came to Beyond Words, she was driving down Route 17 in New Jersey and she saw this brilliant double rainbow in the sky. And her husband, Marco, was to take it from, she said, Pat, we got to pull over and take a picture of it. So they took videos, they took pictures, and then all of a sudden, she said she heard a voice in her head saying, I need you to talk to my father. Now, 7 years, I'm thinking, I'm handling the walk of a bereaved parent very well, but you know, maybe I wasn't. And this further played out the day after the conference. I was driving to Old Forge, New York, which is in the Adirondacks, very beautiful in the fall, change of colors. And I'm hearing the three major conference presenters having this intense spiritual discussion. And I looked up at the sky and said to no one in particular, I want to be where they are. So my soul was crying out for more than I was getting. I was walking the walk of a bereaved parent very well, but obviously something was missing. My head didn't know it, but my soul did, and it cried out for something more. What I was hoping for was just being able to gain enough spiritual knowledge to develop some more clarity in my path and allow me to continue moving forward in grief. What I got was Patty Farino. And that's what spirit manifested. They saw that I needed more than what I was asking for. And then Patty came into my life. And how that again occurred was, there was a conference or a workshop by a colleague by the name of Ron Volano called Embracing the Power of Change. Patty said, you want to come down to Long Island? I will show you my Long Island. And essentially, you can, you know, I called her, said, yeah, I want to come down to the conference. It was in November 10th, I believe. And she said, yeah, I mean, you can stay with me and my husband. I said, are you sure your husband's going to be okay with that? Because I didn't want to get in the way of, you know, any cause any problems. Because no, he'd be fine with it. And he was. And from that weekend, the experience began. That's when I began to embrace a whole new perspective with Patty's guidance. The universe sent me Patty in response to what I had asked for.
So we can get into that a little bit more here in just a moment, but what was your spirituality like before your beautiful daughter Janine passed?
It's interesting that you should ask that, because as an addictions professional, my discussion of spirituality was limited to how to incorporate the 12 steps of AA into your recovery program. That was about as spiritual as I got. My mother was a very spiritual, very intuitive person, and she tried to get me to embrace spirituality, but I didn't. I vehemently rejected it. And I was very much grounded in rational, evidence-based thinking. If I couldn't experience it, a phenomenon with my five senses, it didn't exist. If I couldn't see it in front of me, if it didn't manifest physically, it didn't exist. So I disregarded all things spiritual except for the 12 step. And it was almost, in retrospect, it was almost as if I had a fear of embracing spirituality. And though we didn't put it in the book, I came to find out during my subsequent work with a shamanistic holistic practitioner, the where I believe I found out where that fear originated from.
Are you willing to share?
Of course I am. I just wanted to keep you in suspense for a minute.
So okay.
I just wanted to keep you in suspense. What had happened, and I've been working with a really just very cool, very good shamanistic holistic practitioner by the name of Susan Roback. She's in the Utica area. I've been working with her for years. And she was another person that came into my life through pure serendipity. And so she would put me on the table and, you know, do soul journey. And she would, what I liked about her, I know we were talking before we went on the air about ethics as it relates to spirituality, as it relates to psychology and the other science-based practices. One of the things she said to me, she goes, what I see, there's certain things I may tell you, but there are other things that I may hold back because I don't feel you're ready for that. And I could accept that because it's basically taking into account client need. It's client-centered shamanistic work. And that's what she does. But she said, I want to share something with you. She goes, during the session, I saw you as a young boy, probably 15 or 16, being hung, and this was probably either in Roman or Egyptian times, she had said, because of your spiritual knowledge. So I'm looking back on this. So what she was able to see in another existence, in another time, gave me some clarity as why I vehemently rejected spirituality. Because if I got hung for my spiritual knowledge, you know, I'm going to try to resolve that karma by playing it close to the vest and not even embracing it. It was fear that it carried over from a previous existence that prevented me from embracing spirituality and spiritual practices and integrating that with and seeing the value of integrating that with psychology until I met Pat. So that's kind of it was a gradually evolving process, I mean.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for sharing that. And so one thing that stuck out to me, and you said it here, and also it's in your book, that you said that you felt that you, prior to having met Patty, that you, you said that you were handling or doing well as a bereaved parent, or you thought you were. Can you describe how you thought you were doing well, and then we'll get into more a little bit of, mm-hmm. of what the journey was subsequently.
Well, you know, I think a couple of things on me is that, you know, I was one, probably functional. I was working as an addiction professional, and I loved working with the individuals with substance use issues. I always counted them as my greatest teachers, as among my greatest teachers. Because they are very, very much misunderstood and misunderstood and very much stigmatized. I was starting to begin the beginnings of some bereavement support for other parents who were earlier on in their grief. I seemed on the outside to have it all together. But the thing is that. And one of the things that Patty through Janine showed me in Long Island is that, hey, you're honoring me very well. You're doing the walk very well, but you're forgetting other categories in your life. You're forgetting my brothers. You're forgetting your wife. You're forgetting, you know, there's more to the life experience. You know, the message is I'm going to be here, but I want to see you develop into a better version of yourself by embracing the totality of who you are. It's just not about me. I love what you do with me and I love our connection, but you have to expand your horizons. You have to take care of other categories in your life. And that was something that first came out very loud and clear in terms of what Patty had been channeling through my daughter.
So just to remind everybody, Janine is your daughter.
Yes.
And Patty is the minister who you
That's
met,
right.
Reverend Patty. Yeah. So what did Patty do for you?
Well, we had, after Ron Bolano's event, We returned to her house. She has a, at the time she was living in Long Island. Now she's living in Rock Hill, South Carolina. But in her living room, there's a very sacred space where she had a mantle with all of her, you know, her spirit guides, inspiration. That was her sacred space. We had a fireplace. And she goes, I'm going to light a fire. I want you to get comfortable. And then essentially, she just cut right to the chase. And my daughter in life was somebody who knew how to make a grand entrance. Okay, there was nothing subtle about her entrance. And Patty has basically said, Janine is here with you now, with us now, and she wants to talk with you. And then from there, it was a weekend of spending time with the essence of my daughter, her spirit, through Patty. And I mentioned in the book, there were sometimes it was so realistic that I could, you know, in the beginning, Patty just, I could see a young energy coming about her. She would sit cross-legged. And it was almost like it was, and Janine would do that. So it was almost like Janine was physically inhabiting her body. And she did that at another time. We talk about the infamous oatmeal incident where I was trying to spoon out oatmeal and be very careful. And Patty got real upset and said to me, give me that. And I looked at her and I said, Janine, is that you? Because it was something that Janine would say to me. And that's, of course, Patty got all apologetic later. I said, no, I mean, don't apologize. I said, I understood that. The only way Janine was going to get through to me that this was real is by coming in spirit the way she was in life. That's the only way she was going to get my attention.
So that you could experience her personality and know that it was her.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And from that weekend, it just went to, just greater, you know, Patty, that was the first that Patty introduced me to Native American teachings of animals and nature with Ted Andrews and Jamie Sams, their teachings with medicine cards and animal speaks. Deer medicine was very prominent at that time because I had drawn the deer card, and deer is about gentleness to self and others. And I was having difficulty being gentle to myself. After Janine died. And so everything that happened was in alignment. I mean, everything, you know, and I didn't question it. And there wasn't anything about that weekend that I questioned because I had asked for this. I didn't know I asked for it, but I had asked for this. I said, I want to be where they are. I want to have some greater awareness and greater understanding, greater spiritual knowing, for lack of a better way to put that. And Patty manifested, and then that led into a 10-year relationship, 10-year friendship that morphed into, that was right in the book. And that was, we have a 14-page journal from that weekend, and a lot of what it was in that weekend we didn't put into the book, but we I think we included enough in there so that that individual is reading it could get the picture that our loved ones aren't very far away, is that, in that we are capable of accessing that level of understanding and awareness if we so choose. At the time, Patty was a willing conduit. And the intensity of that weekend was so profound that I was literally shivering. And it was 70 degrees in Long Island. We had a fire going. Patty had to put two blankets on me because I had all this spirit energy running through me. And I was running cold. And so she put two blankets around me so that I could finally warm up, because that's how profound and probably at times overwhelming the experience was for me. And our bodies aren't capable, I don't believe, of handling that kind of energy at light speed. I mean, it was just like I was on overload. So I had to rebalance my energy, but it was an incredible experience. We sat on it for 10 years and we decided to write about it. And we felt that now it was time to write about it, given the current state of affairs in our country with the COVID pandemic. We felt that this book, the time was right for us to write this book. And I tried to convince Patty for a long time. So we got to write a book about this. I think it could help others. And you know, she was very reticent about going public. She was always very private with her knowing, and she wanted to walk in the way that the masters walk, with grace, with dignity, with humility, and to help others who cross their path with her, you know, with her ability to see the world multidimensionally. But she said, you know, now you're right. Now it's time to write the book. And so, and it's a coming out party for both of us. Because I mean, for people who read this book and know me, they're going to know me very well. There isn't anything that I left unsaid in that book about myself or my journey.
Yeah, it's a beautiful story. And you really take the reader on the journey with you and Patty. And so what did that do for your grief? How did that help your grief and loss of your daughter?
Well, you know, and I think once I began to realize that we live in a multidimensional universe, I didn't look at Janine's death the same way again, or her transition the same way again. I looked at the fact that we are capable of making connections to our loved ones wherever we are, and that our loved ones are not that far away. I mean, I've had parents tell me that they've asked their son or daughter for a sign and they've got immediate validation. But what that opened me up was to a whole new way of knowing. And it caused me in a good way to further reassess my beliefs more than I already had. Because as you know, with life-altering, any type of life-altering loss, and it doesn't matter what that loss is, it's, you know, we reassess our beliefs, we reassess our priorities, we reassess our values. The experience of Patty caused me to further reassess my beliefs to say, okay, how can I now begin to integrate and begin to do further exploration? How could I let my scientific curiosity now expand into the spiritual realm? And one of the things that Patty taught me, she goes, look, I don't limit yourself to just me as a teacher. Open yourself up to different teachers. And so because of that, that also opened me up to, and I just basically said to the universe, I'm ready. You know, I'm just give me the people, let the people manifest that are going to help me along in my journey. And you know, I mentioned Susan Roback earlier, I mentioned Patty. There are a variety of people in my circle now are very much intuitive. Some are very grounded in science, but the common ground is that they're all very creative thinkers and they engage in critical thinking and they like to engage in critical discourse. So how this helped me with my grief, and I'm sorry, I digressed a little bit with that, but it's basically gave me peace knowing that my daughter wasn't very far away, knowing that I could create my own connections with her and create connections with other ancestors that I have as well too. So that gave me a whole new understanding of relationships and connection and realizing that I could find peace through that. Although there are days that I would yearn for her physical presence, those days were few and far between because I know that she is present with me. Every time that she manifests her presence, it's a sign of the relationship that we now have. It's a sign of what I now have as opposed to what I had lost in the beginning. Because when I would get what I thought was a sign from her, say, yeah, you know, it's great, but she's not here. Now when I get a sign that she is here. And I've also integrated, I've learned to integrate the best parts of who she is into who I am. And so together we're a package deal. So she's always with me. So I don't necessarily need a sign from her, although she'll throw signs at me, I'll see a lot of threes and ones. Sometimes I'll get hearts, when I'm thinking about her, and it's pretty cool. You know, it's pretty cool to know that we have that kind of relationship now, and that we're, you know, and I firmly believe that we will see each other again too, as well. And that's the message. Every time we get a sign, is that I'm whole, I'm okay. I'm not that far away, and we're going to see each other again.
Well, and it sounds like you were and are very open. And how much do you think that plays a part into people being able to have an experience like what you've had?
I think, Emmy, you need to be open. And I think what intimidates, what makes people hesitant to be open is that they think, well, if I'm open to new perspectives, I now have to abandon my core beliefs. Mm. To make room for those perspectives, and you don't. And I tell my students the same thing, because we talk about a lot of what we've talked about here. I talk in my classes, and I say, look, I'm not here don't confuse my passion about what I believe with me telling you, you have to believe this way. Mm-hmm. I want to open you up to critical thinking. I want to open you up to find your own truth within anything that we talk about. Explore, see where it fits. Take bits and pieces of spiritual perspectives that fit with your existing core beliefs. What we believe doesn't necessarily, it's individualized for everybody, but what we believe is not at the expense of our core beliefs. I'm still firmly grounded in science. I still believe that science has much utility in terms of helping us understand behavior. But I think the integration of different perspectives with our core beliefs gives us a greater context for behavior, helps us look at past trauma very differently, and helps us find some peace with that. And I think the integration of psychology and spirituality does better to promote healing of past trauma than I think either one of those together. I really do. That's my belief. But what I would impress upon your listeners is that embracing new perspectives doesn't mean you eliminate your core beliefs. It's always in addition to, instead of. And that's another thing that Patty taught me. It's always in addition to, never instead of, your core beliefs.
You mentioned signs and symbols. And one that you said that Patty whispered into your ear was about a rainbow. Can you share a little bit about how, because for some people, well, I think really for all people, people need to have an experience in order to believe.
Yep.
So for you, you had those experiences. So could you just share what those were and how they convinced you that this was really your daughter communicating with you?
When Patty and I first talked, when she had trouble registering for the Beyond Words conference, she said, "Did you ever get a sign from my daughter?" And she recalled me saying, "Yeah, I don't really give much." I said, "I don't really put much stock in signs." And I had acknowledged their existence. And I think later in the book, I wanted to clarify that, is that I didn't understand the significance of signs as it could help promote ongoing continued bonds with our loved ones. And continued bonds is a concept that was developed by Dennis Klass back in the 90s and has been extensively researched. And Klass wrote a great book called The Spiritual Lives of Bereaved Parents, which I refer to. And he talks about a framework for grieving that includes a continued bonds perspective, which made a lot of sense to me at that time. But she said, "Did you ever get a sign from your daughter?" And so I told her, I said, I didn't really place much stock in signs, but I said, you know, I think I got a double rainbow from her on Father's Day. It was 2009, because my wife Sherry was out on the deck with her sister, and I was doing something in the living room, probably doing something for school. No, that wouldn't have been for school. I was probably doing something on a computer, and she goes, Dave, you got to get out here. She goes, I think this double rainbow is a gift from your daughter saying Happy Father's Day. So I told Patty that, and then when she saw the double rainbow and heard my daughter Janine whisper in her ear, "I need you to talk to my father," she put two and two together. And she says, "I think Janine wants us to get together." So that's how that whole thing happened.
Mm. Right. So sort of, you call it serendipity or a synchronicity, where there's two events that seem related. And so that gives you that validation. It sounds like you've had many of those experiences regarding your daughter.
Well, and once I began to open myself up to the fact that communication can occur from different dimensions, the universe has manifested bringing people in my life who not only supported me, but were individuals that would help me take the next step in my evolution of grief. And once I began opening myself up to signs and knowing where my daughter was, it helped me embrace a peaceful perspective as far as grief goes. It helped me embrace that peaceful perspective, knowing that, that we do survive death. We exist in a different form of energy.
And so your grief, how is your grief now regarding your daughter?
I honor my grief. There are days where I will have moments of sadness. there might be days where I'll have total sadness. I remember in her, just prior to her 18th or 17th angelversary day, I felt the profound sadness and grief. And I had written about that in a blog. And it was the realization that in her 18th year of living in spirit, she will have lived in spirit as long as she would have been alive. And for many parents and for many individuals, not just parents, but for many individuals who are long-term grievers, that's a milestone that, you know, I use that term loosely. That is something that really can bring you back into the deep depths of sadness. Mm-hmm. And I realized that I had heard other parents talk about this, heard other individuals talk about that, and I was living it. But the difference was that I in 18 years as opposed to 1 year, I began to expect that I would have those moments, that it's just not being about happy. It's just that it's about experiencing all the emotions that life's going to throw at you. And that kind of comprises the mosaic of the mosaic of the path that we now walk as individuals who are trying to transcend challenge. So I've just learned to make room for all of it. But for the most part, I understand, and those sad moments don't cause me to be fearful, don't cause me to suppress my grief. It's okay, it's here, let me deal with it. What does my sadness have to teach me about this moment of my grief? And how can I move forward? But just realizing where the sadness was coming from, I knew how to deal with it. I knew that I was experiencing something that many long-term grievers experience, is that when your loved one has been in spirit longer than they've been alive, or as long as they've been alive in the physical world. So, but for the most part, I'm at peace with, and you know, I get much joy out of my family, and certainly with my students who I love dearly, and who I sometimes will feel the young energy of my daughter coming through, because I tell my students I'm 65 years old, but I feel like I haven't had a growth spurt yet. So, and I said I'm probably not going to grow up anytime soon. So, it's just going to be. I mean, attitudinally, I feel like I'm 30, you know. But so that's, you know, that embracing these different perspectives has caused me to have renewed focus, has contributed to have renewed focus, renewed vigor, and just renewed awe at what the universe has to offer, even in times of challenges. There's a quote from one of my favorite books on the Afterlife of Billy Fingers by Andy Kagan. It's a quote from Billy to Annie. And Billy, the quick premise of the book is, and this book was released on my daughter's 10th angelversary day. So you want to talk about serendipity? It was released on March 1st, 2003. Annie Kagan's brother, Billy, had danced with addiction all of his life. And he died. He was actually, I think, hit by a bus. He was leaving against medical advice from a detox. And I believe he got hit by a bus. 3 weeks to the day that he died, and on her birthday, he began to have extended communications with her from the afterlife. So she documented all of his teachings. They put it together in a book, which essentially they co-authored. And one of the things he said is, I think it's, and I'm paraphrasing this, is when there is joy, the light will be there. When there is hardship, the light will be there. So in times of joy and hardship, look for the light, look for the love. And that's what it's all about. The divine source is about love. We're not meant to be on earth to serve a sentence or to be punished. Some people are given, you know, so some people have different challenges that they have to transcend than others. All of the challenges are unique to their own path and just as significant. But, you know, we all have challenges that we're going to need to transcend for the evolution of our physical bodies, but more for the evolution of our souls.
Absolutely. Very well said. And so how has your experiences with Patty connecting with your daughter, Janine, provided more meaning and purpose in your life? Because that's a big part of spirituality as well.
Mm-hmm. I had thought about this. And one of the things is that one of the things that resonated, many things that Patty has taught me that's resonated with me, is that you can make your own connections with your daughter. You don't need me to do that for you. You can do it yourself. I can show you how to do it, but you don't need me. And that's one of the things that I loved about her, is that she empowers people to find their own paths. She doesn't foster dependency, which is what I one of the things that's great about her. She will expose you to tools and encourage you to use those. She'll provide guidance, but she encourages you can do this. She wants to inspire more, as you know, she wants to inspire more masters. She wants to inspire more individuals who can teach and go forward and make a difference in the world. So she said, why not? And her eighth angel versary, and eight is, you know, from numerology, if you take eight, you invert it to the horizontal position, you have the infinity symbol, which is a sign of eternal life and power. She said, why don't you create a ritual or a ceremony, or as she called it, but an activity to connect with your daughter on her eighth angel versary. So we both loved music. And so I created a 5:30 in the morning. I picked that purposely, because if you had 5, 3, and 0, it's 8. So I did that. I lit some incense. I put together a playlist. I asked Janine to inspire some of the songs that would be on there. And I just sat down and I called her in, told her how much I appreciated her and loved her, and just asked her to spend some time with me. So I hit the iPad on shuffle mode. First two songs that came up were songs by the Gin Blossoms and the Goo Goo Dolls. Now, that was significant because the first concert I ever took her to was at the age of 13, had those two bands. So she was telling me, I'm here. So I spent about an hour, we spent an hour listening to music, and I had peace the rest of the entire day. So then, and then I learned that you don't have to wait till angelversaries or birthdays, you can do that connection anytime. But what was also significant in my evolution in terms, and we talked, I think, before we got on the air about letting go and letting God. In the 11th year, I talked to Patty about doing another specific activity involving music. And I think I burned some incense. I think I had some sweetgrass incense that I burned. And what I did is I was listening to music, but at that point, I told my daughter, I said, I have appreciated your guidance. I've appreciated your wisdom. I've appreciated you showing me a new reality and a multidimensional reality. But it's time for you to move on, just and not just take care of me. So I gave her permission to grow outside of me and said, I know your role transcends just being a wise guy to me. You have more responsibilities in the spirit world. I want you to embrace that. In real life, as parents, we talk about cutting the apron strings, you know, letting our children learn from their own mistakes, forge their own path. But it occurred to me that I never did that with her in spirit. So that was the other point that I learned to let go and said, you know, it was, for me, I looked at it as a day of rebirth, because, and I looked at for both of us, and I said, I want you to, and I'm getting chills just talking about this, and I want you to dance in the universe and help whomever needs my help, needs your help. Yeah. It's just not about me anymore. It's about your greater purpose as a highly evolved spiritual being. Well, we mentioned, you know, I mentioned the afterlife of Billy Fingers, and I think his, you know, that was his nickname, but his, I think his real name was Bill Cohen, and he danced with addiction all of his life. And we've talked about how stigmatized addiction is, okay, but he went from the earthly walk of walking the path of an individual with substance use issues to this highly evolved spiritual being, and in the book he explains this is the path I chose. This is, I needed to find my truth within the path that I took. And the book, that book not only gave me another perspective on the afterlife, but also for those in the families who are looking for a new perspective, who have had loved ones who have had addiction, it destigmatizes addiction. It gives a kind of more of a sacred explanation for the path that he took, and to look beyond, the physical experience, or look at the spiritual experience of that whole piece.
You're such a rich resource, and I know you've been talking about these topics and speaking publicly and nationally on this topic for a number of years. So I know you have so much to share, and I will definitely have you back on the podcast, Dave, and we'll have more conversations. So how has this experience that you've gone through changed how you teach your psychology courses?
Well, the first thing is that, and I'm gonna do this for two courses, because I teach principles of behavior change course, which is about using evidence-based principles to help individuals achieve different behaviors and establish different behaviors, acquire different behaviors, and also the death, dying, and bereavement course. So there are two different ways that I integrate. With the principles of behavior change course, I will routinely introduce concepts, and I also teach addictions counseling as well too. So in those courses, I will routinely introduce spiritual concepts that can go very well with science, particularly things like yoga, meditation, acupuncture, contemplation. We'll talk about automatic writing, in terms of as a tool. I've introduced other resources as far as, I've introduced, somebody we both know very well, Becky Clausen's book, Changemaker. I've introduced your book on intuitive development just recently to my students.
Thank you for that.
Well, you're welcome. And it's a great resource. It's a great resource that it just melds the world of both science and spirituality very beautifully. And you and Becky did that very well. So I routinely do that in my psychology courses. In my death, dying, and bereavement course, we will talk about near-death experiences. We talk about Evan Alexander's, and specifically his book, Proof of Heaven. And we should share the interview of his experience. We talk about Brian Weiss's work, Many Lives, Many Masters, and we talk about his work of past life regression therapy and how that work has helped people achieve clarity and peace by doing past life regression work. We've also talked about Ian Stevenson and Jim Tucker's at the University of Virginia, their studies, reincarnation studies that they did with children. 2,500 children, I believe, and they found 1,200 cases that were solved, which meant that it indicated that there was evidence that this child was the reincarnation of another soul. So we talk about all of these perspectives. And also in another course the general psych course that I teach, we will talk about these perspectives as well as the mind-body connection with Dan Condren's permanent healing. And I can also see intuitive development being a part of that as well, too, being a resource that I introduced there, because you talk very eloquently about the mind-body-spirit connection and utilizing a variety of different perspectives. So that's how that's changed for me, is that I don't limit myself. I expose them to areas where they can begin to engage in critical thinking and they can begin to expand their own horizons. Because as a professor, as a teacher, I believe that's an obligation to my students. It's not just teaching them a curriculum. It's going beyond that and expanding their horizons so that they can find their own truth within different perspectives that they can choose to integrate all of or parts of or none of.
I wish you were my psychology professor. Those are some lucky students, Dave.
Well, thank you. And I consider myself lucky, because these students, particularly they came into my life at a time where I was struggling with Janine's loss. And I had I had committed to teaching when Janine was in a an upswing in her cancer treatment, where she was feeling better, had some energy. But my first contract occurred in January of 2003. And I started teaching in January 2003, and then she began to deteriorate. But I couldn't get out of the contract, and I had to really gut my way through that first semester. But the students were wonderful. They knew what had happened. They were supportive, and they have become part of my extended soul family. Every student that I've ever had in the 18 years has become part for that semester of my extended family, because I learned from them. They are great teachers to me. They're a great presence to me, and they inspire me. And they got me through, along with the rest of that community at Utica College, the staff and the faculty, got me through some tough times and some dark days.
Oh, you're making me tear up. That's beautiful.
Well, yeah, they, I love them all, you know.
Oh, well, I'm so glad you had those students to help you through, and you've all learned a lot from each other. So how has the receptivity been among your psychology and addiction counselor peers to all these resources that you mentioned? Because it does seem that academia could use a little overhaul, or a little, or expansion on core beliefs. That's a better way to say it, right?
I think so. I think we have to learn in certain areas of academia that one size does not fit all. As a clinician, I have learned that one size does not fit all. As a clinician, it's about client-centered therapy. It's me and the client, where they're at. It's meeting what they believe their presenting problems are in the moment. And it's our job to be present, to witness and honor that, and help them forge a path. But I also think that once we forge a path based on their own individual preferences, we can then begin to gently point out other areas that they may want to work on, but understanding that it's their, you know, it's their decision in terms of what they do. I've had right now two colleagues who have purchased the book, and both have had favorable reviews. They've appreciated the open-mindedness. I think they've appreciated the open-mindedness. They like the way the book was written. One of my students bought the book, and he's as grounded in science as anybody. And he told me, he said, you know, he goes, I might have trouble believing some of this stuff, but he goes, I know you wouldn't write about it if it wasn't true. So I have to really pay attention to that. So the response I've gotten has been positive so far. It will be interesting to see, as more and more of my colleagues decide to buy the book, what then they're, you know, that are science-based, what their reaction is going to be. I know that there will be questions, but I will tell them I welcome questions. I welcome critical discourse, because that's how we both learn. And I will tell them, if you can give me a scientific explanation totally for any of this that happened to me, I'm willing to listen, but I haven't been able to find it.
Yeah.
You know, I haven't been able to find it. So, and also I got to put in a brief plug for Utica College. I just got a $2.8 million grant to start a Center for Integrative Medicine, which is going to be looking globally at ways to integrate spiritual practices with science-based models, which I'm really excited about. And that's just in the beginning phase right now. And so I think at this point, I'm encouraged, because at least our university is seeing that we need to do more of an integrative approach is going to be helpful. And I think the research has borne that out, that, integrating science with spirituality helps individuals develop greater clarity and purpose, and helps them achieve their goals, probably greater than either one together. It's like, if you look at the 12-step model, I believe a combination of a competent therapist with 12-step support, that combination together, I think, helps individuals achieve better outcomes, more longer-term sobriety, and maybe either one of those alone. I know that there will be questions, but I'm ready to answer questions. It isn't about, no, I'm not going to answer that because you don't believe that. It's just, hey, we can bear witness to people who have different belief systems, and we can learn from all of that.
Yeah. Well, and you've shared a lot of resources, and for those who are wanting to learn more, there's so much out there that can support people to have these experiences. And you've mentioned many of those today. So what does spirituality or God mean to you?
I looked at that question and I said, wow. I said, because boy, that has so many meanings. First of all, I look at God as kind of the divine source of all life and wisdom. I don't put a figure to him. And I know in certain religions, particularly Catholicism, we have Jesus, you know, you have Buddha, you have Allah, but I don't put I just look at him. I look at God as the divine source of all life and wisdom. And I believe that my spirit guides can routinely connect to that divine source of wisdom. So, and I believe we can all, as mentioned earlier, we're all capable of connecting to the divine if we're open to it. And, you know, we can do it in our own unique way, whether it's through meditation, whether it's through yoga, whether it's through movement, whether it's through just simply contemplation, whether it's calling in our loved ones into our sacred space. We can all do that. But that's how I look at God. I don't particularly look at him as a specific figure, but I look at him as an essence that is the divine source of all life and wisdom, and that we can connect to at any time. But that was a great question. I looked at that and said, wow. And because I'm not particularly, I don't subscribe to a particular religious doctrine. I've been raised Catholic, but I'm kind of, as what Kent Nerburn would refer himself to, I'm kind of like a guerrilla spiritualist. I take a little bit of Native Americans' teachings, maybe a little bit of Buddhism, maybe some stuff from Christianity, and I put it together. I'm kind of like a mad chemist. I kind of mix it together to have my own, you know, spiritual identity. So, but that's how I look at God. I look at that's my conception of God.
Wonderful description. And thank you so much, Dave, for all that you've shared with us today. I hope everyone gets a copy of your very inspiring and uplifting. I actually just lost my mother a month ago. And even though I'm a quite spiritual person, it's as you said, you can't really prepare for what will happen when you lose a loved one or have these experiences that make you really connect and want to connect more to that spirituality. And the book had a very soothing effect on me. So thank you for that. And to you and Patty.
Well, you're welcome. And please accept on behalf of Patty and myself, our condolences for the loss of your mom. I mean, it doesn't matter. You know, the illusion that sometimes that we may be under is that after we've experienced what we believe is the most life-altering loss, we may think it's not going to happen again, but it's going to. If we live long enough, we're going to experience loss. And every loss will open up the wounds, will open up grief, because every loss has its significance. There's a significant difference in relationships. There's a significant relationship that we are all going to grieve. But what I believe is that we can rely on the strengths that we've developed and the resources in terms of dealing with previous losses to get us through the current loss. But it's something that grief needs to be experienced. It can't be suppressed. It needs to be experienced. And, you know, we need to just let it run its course and just let the good as well as the joyful and peaceful moments envelop us, because we can learn from everything.
What is the best way for people to get in touch with you?
If they would like to get in touch with Patty and I about our book, or if they would like to book a speaking engagement with us about the book, or ways that we can talk about integrating psychology with spirituality, they can reach us through our email at psychologyprofessorandminister@gmail.com. Our website is also psychologyprofessorandminister.com. And also we have a page dedicated to our book, When the Psychology Professor Met the Minister, with a link to Amazon where they can purchase it if they're interested. And also I'm on Facebook. I have to put props to my son for this. I mean, he calls me the world's oldest millennial. And because I'm on Facebook, I'm on Twitter, I'm on Instagram, and I'm on LinkedIn. So if people want to get in touch with me individually there, and if they lose track of our email address, they can get in touch with me that way as well too.
Absolutely. Well, Dave, thank you so much for being with us, and I look forward to having more conversations with you.
I look forward to having more conversations with you. I mean, it was a pleasure.
For me as well. And thank you all for being with us and joining us. Until next time, be well. Bye for now.